the meeting to order. First, order of business, pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, the next agenda item is public remarks. If you'd like, there is a microphone up here at the front of the room. If you don't want to use the microphone, just please speak loudly and clearly. I would ask you to state your name, your address, and, you know, there may be a number of people who want to speak, so please try to keep your comments relatively brief. So with that, are there anybody who wants to make a public remark?
Very short. I'm here as a Board of Ed member as well as a resident in support of the 3.75 for the education budget plus the contingency plan within the budget proposal and ask the Board of Finance allow that the budget go forward without any reduction. I hope the Board of Finance understands the due diligence that the Board of Ed performed when reviewing the budget, including adhering to contract obligations and reviewed what was truly needed to simply maintain the integrity of the education. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Nancy Oakley, 71 Coconut Park Drive. Also, I'll be brief. Just a few very simple points. I'm asking for the same thing, just that the Board of Finance and then, of course, later the Town Council support the unanimously approved by the Board of Education 3.75% budget with the contingency. It seems to be an extremely responsible and conservative approach, to be honest, and I'm in full support of it. I further think that part of the point of bifurcating the budgets seemed to be to, from what I heard, increase transparency and also allow the voters to have even more, I suppose, of a say or a better view on each budget and then to have that say. And so I do ask that the Board of Finance puts forth this budget as proposed with no reduction so that the people can vote at referendum on it. So thank you very much.
Nancy Kohler, over 31 Daniel Street. I have nothing new or different. I just want to echo the sentiments of these two ladies and say I also am here on behalf of my husband and myself, both parents and taxpayers, in support of Superintendent Smith's proposed budget that was also approved unanimously by the Board of Education. I hope that you will allow this budget to go through and let the taxpayers of New Hampshire decide.
And I have nothing to add to these ladies, but I wholeheartedly support that same call.
Anyone else?
Hi, I'm Molly Sherman, 24 Heavy Road. I'm also here tonight in support of the Board of Ed budget. I got to attend a couple of those meetings, so I know how many things on the wish list were already taken out. It really is a bare bones budget. It's quite literally the least we can do for our children, and I would encourage you tonight to pass it.
Anyone else?
GRE 814 Champion Hill. I'm not going to say anything that you haven't already heard, but I'm also in support of the budget, and they did say it worked great.
Sherry Bannock, 47 Peach Farm Road, and I'm here to also support the budget as it is presented to go to referendum.
Sherry Adams, I live at 14 Royals Avenue, and I also want to support the budget.
I'm Dan Gardner at 131 Comstock Trail. I'm also here to support the budget, and I just
that brief, but that's okay. I think everyone has a problem now. All right, so 2017-2018 budget presentations. Mike, do you want to go first?
Thank you. Do I need the microphone, or can everybody hear me? There it is. You guys are good in the back. All right, I don't know if everybody got a copy. There are some copies up here of the town manager's proposed budget for 2017-18. Highly recommend it. We will have copies on the town website as well, for those of you who want to get copies later. So let's go for our first slide here. I'm sure if you've come to these budget presentations in years before, you've probably seen this slide. I'm going to point out a couple differences for you this year compared to some previous years. Probably the biggest and the first one is on the right side, education. As you can see, due to the bifurcation of the town's budget and the change in the way the charter's written, there is no chance or opportunity for the manager to make a recommendation on the budget now, so it just gets passed on to the Board of Finance. A couple other things in terms of debt, that's like the town's mortgage payment. We want to make sure we make our mortgage payment, so of course there's no reduction in that. That dollar amount is what it is. Transfers in capital, I've recommended a reduction of about $288,000. And town operating budget, I've recommended a reduction of about $631,000. Let's move on here. This is always a good way to look at our overall budget. And a lot of these charts, just so everybody's aware, the way we did this is we did put education and town government together in a lot of these charts in the presentation. So that way, all of you can see the whole picture of what you're looking at. Because I think it's important to make an informed decision and see the whole picture. So as you can see from this chart, 69% goes to education. Town operating is approximately 23%, followed by debt, which is 6%. And then capitals and transfers, which is 2%. Okay, one of the helpful ways to look at our budget is to take a 10-year snapshot and look back 10 years and see where we were 10 years ago and look at where we are today. So, you know, we saw that pie chart of all those different parts. This is the snapshot looking back again. You can see 2008 on the left side versus today, and the proposed budget on the right side. The blue column is education, the orange column is town operation, and then the gray column on the right is debt and transfers. You can kind of see they're about in the same ballpark. There's been a little bit of shifts and changes little by little, but that's kind of where we are. All right. So what does this mean in dollars and cents? So what we're looking for is a total increase to the town's budget is approximately $3,006,707. And where does that all go? So first and foremost, the proposal, the 3.75 for the Board of Education, we heard a number of people stand up and talk about that. That's right there in education in the blue part. Then you're looking at that big gray piece there. What is that? That's in the governor's proposed budget this year. He's recommended that a number of municipalities, including ours, make a contribution to the teacher's retirement pension fund. So that's the $1.6 million teacher's retirement requirement that we would have to pay. If you want to look at some of the other things, transfers to other funds is actually decreasing. Town operations is increasing by $281,000. And then debt service, I believe, is $48,000. Well, that's not changed there. All right, let's talk about expenditures. And specifically for the general government budget. A lot of the business that we do is very person-focused, people-focused. They're the jobs that machines and robots and computers cannot do. By putting people in plow trucks, putting people in police cars, putting people at a window to receive your money. A lot of that cannot be done by computers. So as you can see, some of our larger increases are a result of salaries. Specifically, we are looking to increase or add the additional funding for a full-time police officer next year. This year, as you probably heard, one of our officers was injured. We came forward with a proposal during mid-year looking for funding to help offset that loss of that individual. It's probably going to be a lot longer, so we're looking for that additional funding to go for the rest of that year. You can also see there's a decrease. Wherever possible, we try to be as efficient and as effective as possible. That is a part-time position in the assessor's office. He's talking about being able to do that part-time position's job more effectively by using contractors and consultants and computer equipment. So we're actually reducing that $6,000. It's going into a consulting line. Let's see, medical benefits. I think that's an important one to talk about. As you'll note throughout this entire conversation, this year's budget is surrounded by questions. I think there's a lot of questions out there, questions from the state of the state, right down to some of our basic operating things. Health insurance is a big item with a question mark this year. This year we sat down with our health insurance provider for all our employees, and they proposed somewhere north of a 28% increase, I believe. That put us in a situation where we had to take some drastic measures. That's a lot of money. The 28% increase, we were talking about upwards of $300,000 added to our budget, to the general operating budget. As a result, we put it out to bid. We got bids back. We talked about what we got back. We looked at all our options. We decided that we're going to move forward with the Connecticut Partnership Plan, which is a state-run plan for municipalities that all can get in. It'll actually reduce our medical costs by about $146,000. So that's a win for everybody. There's a caveat to that. We need to negotiate with all of our collective bargaining units. They need to agree to it. We need to come to an agreement on it. And they need to be in it and ready to go for April 1. So we were very up against the gun in getting that done. Pension. One thing to note with the pensions, the town council's worked very hard over the last 4 years at sunsetting our pension plan. I'm sure everybody's heard about how pensions have ruined cities and Detroit and other cities around going bankrupt because of pensions. Our council's worked very hard at sunsetting our pension plan, and in place of that pension plan, they've put together a defined contribution plan. Similar to like everybody who has a 401k, we have something called a 401a. So as you'll see, under there you can see defined contribution plan coming in at $20,000. As new people are hired, they're hired on that defined contribution plan, adding money to that line item. Whereas the line item above, the defined benefit plan, that number should, as we get more people into the defined contribution plan, go down. Workers' compensation and liability insurance, another big question mark. As you can imagine, our workers' compensation this year, as a result of having an officer hurt and some other surgeries that other employees had to have done, has been a little bit challenging. We were seeing somewhere upwards of a 50% increase at one point. As a result, we've sat down with our current carrier. We've had a lot of hard conversations, a lot of long talks. We're currently taking a look at what if we were able to combine our workers' compensation and our liability insurance together? That's something that our carrier hasn't considered in previous years as a result of kind of the tumultuous history that we've had. But because we've been a pretty good community moving forward these last few years, they've said, you know what, we'll consider that this year. And there might be a twofer deal that we could get. We're also looking at other opportunities for workers' comp in other places. Right now, $86,000 is our estimate. We'll see what they come back with moving forward. There we go. I'm going to punch the rest of these on there. There we go. There. Nope, we got it. All right. A couple other things. Connecticut Natural Gas. Everybody remembers the gas project. We went through and lived through the disasters on our road for almost an entire summer. We saw it happen. As a part of making that whole situation work, the town entered into a community agreement. We have to pay approximately $100,000 a year. Last year, the first year's payment came in. The way that agreement is worded is we're supposed to pay approximately $100,000 equal to what they pay in taxes. last year when we did the tax forms for personal property, they had not actually completed. So as a result, we only received about half in the taxes. As a result, we made an agreement with them that we would only pay them $50,000 last year. This year, because it's all online, we'll be getting that $100,000 in taxes. They now will pay them the other $50,000, so we will be paying $100,000. That's for approximately 4 more years. We have 4 more years left on that agreement. The building department. If there's a silver lining, it is the activity in the building department. I can tell you that we have the busiest building department in any of our surrounding towns around us. They're doing an excellent job at keeping that place going. They are absolutely moving every day. There are permits coming in, activity going on. In this time last year, they were looking at 1 new housing start. We're currently looking at 4. So we're expecting that to be a very busy place, and it's going to continue to be busy and become busier. So this year, what we're doing is we're asking for a part-time person to help with some of those inspections. Public Works. I think everybody saw we did some line striping last year. We've done catch basin cleaning every year. The price of those things go up. We're looking to do a little bit more of it next year. That's an increase there. Everybody's heard about our canine program. This year we're asking for $10,000. That goes to its annual training as well as equipment and supplies for the dog. As different things wear out, we need to replace it. The dog is also required to go to a training for a certain period of time. We need to backfill with officers in that place while that dog is doing that training. Fire marshal. Just like the building department's busy, the fire marshal's also busy. This year, the building code changed as well as the fire code. So we have to upgrade the fire marshal's fire safety code book as well as his software that goes along with it. That is an expensive proposition at $10,000. And lastly, information technology. For those of you who don't know, a lot of our servers, electronics, and backup systems in the town hall are placed underneath water pipes, sewage pipes, and if you saw pictures of them, I was downstairs looking at them today. They're in a very scary condition, and it's not an if they're going to break, but a when they're going to break. So disaster recovery and cloud backup is one of the most important things that we do. Mr. Jilka and the IT department have done an excellent job at putting that together and setting us up in a situation, hopefully, that we never have to use. But in the event we needed to, there's the possibility we could operate out of a hotel room given a period of time. The total of all of our increased expenditures this year, we're looking at $209,394. What does that look like in relation to the last 10 years for percentage increase? Take a look here. You can see that the average percentage increase over the years has been 2.4% for general operating government. This year we're looking at a 2.7%. So we're just a little above, but we fall pretty much in line with where we have been every other year. There we go. So employees. You know, we talked a little bit about employees. We are a people-driven business. What does that mean for full-time equivalents? If we look back to 2008, we had 66 full-time equivalents. That's 66 full-time employees. We're now down at 62.5. We're requesting an additional 0.5 employee, which will bring us to 63. We are a bigger town today than we were in 2008, with a lot more service requests and requirements. All right. Town operations proposed budget change. So, this is kind of another way of looking at it. Remember, we are a people-driven business. You can see there's a bunch of different categories here, and breaking those out, salaries and wages being the largest. Purchase and professional services, followed by dues and fees, supplies and equipment, employee benefits, and then new staff and program requests down at the bottom. So you can see we're really reducing the amount of what we're requesting for the new people. Now, another one of those categories we looked at on our first slide, debt and capital. This is our mortgage payment. This is the payment that's coming out for paying for the high school, paying for roads, paying for equipment. But I want to draw your attention. There's a couple orange boxes on the top there. This is probably one of the first years we've had something like that show up on there. This last year, we had a plow truck catch on fire. And the council made the decision that we would do a lease-to-buy scenario. Probably one of the first times we've done that. Those are some of those payments. We've also done a couple other lease-to-buy scenarios for boilers in all of our town facilities when we changed them over to natural gas. And I think, as we move on, there we go. Capital, you can see there's another lease-to-buy in our capital plan this year. There we go. So, in our capital plan this year, you're looking at $110,000 under education. That is a lease-to-buy scenario for some computer and IT equipment for the Board of Education. Also, it's important to note, under public safety, there's gray columns. Those are funds from other areas. So that $35,696, that is funds left over from our natural gas conversion project. What we were able to do is we were able to save money by doing that during that project through working more efficiently and more effectively. We put about $35,000 in our pocket, and we're going to use that to change over some other boilers in other places. Also, Public Works, the $75,000, that's coming from a state grant, LOSIP. We believe we'll be able to get it. We'll see how that goes going forward. Now, we've talked about all the expenditures and the money going out, but let's talk about the money coming in. And as I said, there's a lot of things surrounded by questions. When we talk about revenues, there's even bigger and even more questions. So, we've adjusted our estimates for a few different places. Our mill rate stabilization fund, we've had to reduce that down. The planned transfer for this year, for 2018, is approximately $132,608. That is the fund that was put aside in order to offset the increase of the high school building project. So we're bringing those additional funds in to help offset. Grants. This is where we talk about the state of the state. I think everybody's heard about what the governor did. I think we all kind of have heard what his budget could do, but this is brass tacks. This is where it meets the road, and this is what it really does to East Hampton. So we're looking at a cut of $3.3 million to the education cost-sharing grant. We're looking at a special education excess cost grant for $1.7 million. We're looking at grants for municipal projects, a reduction of $18,000. And then municipal revenue sharing, we're looking at getting about $115,000. The net effect of the proposed reductions are equal to over 1.3 mils in our budget. So that's only 1.3 mils in our budget that will be a result of the state credit. All right, delinquent tax collection. This is one place I wanted to point out. We have a very busy tax collector and tax collection office. If you owe taxes in the town of East Hampton, I highly recommend you pay them. We are working very hard at increasing our tax collection rate. I believe last year it was at around 97%+. We're hoping to get upwards of 98-99% this year. Tell your neighbors. There we go. All right, this is always an interesting slide to look at. Again, comparing 2008, 2013, and then our estimate for this year. This shows a couple different buckets. Grants, licenses, permits, and fees. Property taxes and all other. And you're saying, all right, what does it really show me? I think if you take a look at that grants column, you can see the grants are going down. And if you take a look at the property taxes column, the property taxes are going up. So you can see there's a direct correlation between the two. You could also see our licenses, permits, and fees have actually reduced by 0.8, and all the other has actually gone down quite a bit as well. By almost 0.5, 0.6. Okay, our licenses, permits, and fees. You know, I talked about how we are the busiest building department around. We are keeping an average of approximately $459,000 worth of licenses, permits, and fees every year. I think, and we are estimating we're probably going to be around that, maybe a little bit more than the average. It's good news for us because we're seeing some growth, we're seeing some things happen. On the other side, it means we have more services we need to provide. All right, talk about investment income. I think this is probably the saddest slide that we have in the whole group. You can see at one point we were talking about $278,000 in investment income back in 2008. Since then, you can see it has dropped significantly. It's down to about $22,500 is what we're expecting this year. I think if you want to put any silver lining on it, we can borrow money at a ridiculously low rate now. So if there's anything, there's that. All right, talk about our grand list. Our grand list has remained relatively unchanged since the 2017 budget estimate. And there's a couple things that I think we need to point out and things that could change as a result of this. You know, we're looking at our grand list being around $1,128,957,021. But this year, when you look at it, for our budget estimate, you can see we're down a little bit. And you're going to say, why? And I think there's a couple things that are out there that we're still looking at as questions. We've got a couple court cases that are very large dollar amounts in terms of people's assessments. And we're currently working through those. We're hoping those will change things a little bit. Also, in previous years, our Board of Assessment Appeals has reduced our grand list by approximately $3 million. So we're trying to account for that this year. Again, if there's a silver lining to be seen, we see that there's been a pickup in personal property. And that's probably coming along with some of that building activity. So we have seen an increase. All right, so you're saying, how are we going to pile this together? What does it mean? Okay, what does it mean? We are looking at a total expenditure of $45,958,311. We take the total revenue before taxes, so that's the money we're getting from the state, the money we're getting from licenses and permits and other grants and everything else. That comes to $8,657,824. We say, okay, subtract those two, the property taxes needed are $37,300,487. We know the value of a mill is $1,105,732, which gives us an estimated mill rate next year of 33.72 mills. Okay, so total mill increase. We're looking at a 4.29 mill increase. Now, I know there's a lot of people there probably saying, oh my gosh. A good part of that, a big part of that, can be related to the governor's proposed budget. You can actually account for 2.75 mills because of the governor's budget. Just to run you through again, that gray on top of the education side, that's the $1.6 million for the teacher's retirement. Underneath that is 0.99 mills for their operating budget. Revenue loss, again, 1.46 mills. Town operating accounts for 0.3 mills. Capital and transfers accounts for 0.08 mils. Debt service accounts for 0.04. And then our grand list, we're actually estimating it'll be down just a little bit. All right, and that's where we get to the end, and I have my little pitch. It's great that we have so many people here. We need to continue to have people here and be involved. The budget process for our town involves a lot of people and a lot of voices, and it's important that you're here from the beginning all the way through to the end, and you understand every piece in between. As the Board of Finance goes through the budget, they've got a lot of work that they're going to do. I think it's informative for residents to be here. It provides you an opportunity for your voice to be heard, and it provides opportunities for them to hear what you're interested in. I would also, first of all, highlight March 14th. That probably is going to be canceled. I don't know why, it's just something I heard. But every other budget workshop, you will be able to hear different departments present their budgets individually. From the department heads, you'll hear from the police chief, from the public works director, from the superintendent, from everybody else that works in the town directing a department to provide their information. So if you have any interest in being there, I highly recommend it. I think you'll find it insightful. You'll find out the inner workings of all of our departments and the way that we work, why the plows run at the time that they run, why there's this many police cars, why there's a town hall in this location and not that location. Everything will be discussed. So, note those dates. I highly hope that you're all there. And thank you for spending the time tonight and spending the time as I go through this. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening, and thank you very much for coming. Many of you have sat through a longer presentation of my budget proposal that we've done at several of the board meetings, so tonight is a shortened version. Online and in the budget books is the complete version with an explanation, so please go to the website. It's been updated with all of the new slides and the government proposal. First, before I begin, I just want to take a moment and compliment Karen Aceta, our business manager, and our business office. Last year's budget book was recognized by the Connecticut Association of Boards of Education as the best budget book in the state. And I think that they have outdone themselves, because we actually can no longer use the binder that we used, the system, because it's too thick. It has even more information. So I apologize to Board of Finance members. Your budget book is falling apart. But we do have them in three-ring binders over on that table, Board of Ed members as well. But I urge you to go through this book. The information is incredible. There's all of the information is online on our website. It has a longer version of the PowerPoint with an explanation for each slide that I'm going to talk about tonight. And in the back is a line-by-line item of every single line item in the budget. And if you have any questions, please call me, please call Karen. We'll be glad to answer any questions that anybody has. So I'm just going to fly through quickly. I am urging everybody in our community, as this great resource, the high school, comes online, to take full advantage of the offerings. Our auditorium can seat up to, it's very comfortable for 100 to up to 500 people. The T-Bell, we're calling it, for 60 to 70 to 80 people. There's other spaces in the library and the tea room. Now that it's online, any group in town, any nonprofit group, is welcome to hold any meeting or any training session there. And we're really looking forward to getting the community into the school to take advantage. Each of these little icons here is a separate slide that I took time in January to talk about. But I think you need to know that this community is getting a very good return on investment in its schools. From the top left, America's Top High Schools by Newsweek, one of 16 schools in Connecticut. The AP Honor Roll just to the right, one of 14 schools in Connecticut to be on the AP Honor Roll. The College Board AP Scholars, 39 students from the graduating class of 2016, or 35% of the students who took AP exams were recognized as AP Scholars. The SAT scores for the class of 2016, the second highest in our district reference group. Down at the bottom, HeartSmart 2020, we're making the effort without putting as many budget dollars as I would like, but we're making the effort to make sure by 2020, every student who graduates from East Hampton High School is trained in CPR, and we're working to make sure by that year, every single staff member in the East Hampton Public Schools is trained in CPR. To the right of the heart is Gianna Russell, the 14th student since 1952 to score 1,000 points during her high school basketball career. And to see our sports teams, both basketball teams, deep into the state playoffs. They've been eliminated after the semifinal round, but to make it that deep into the playoffs is just wonderful. Just briefly, the MyOn program on the bottom left, the digital reading program, paid for by our PTO, over 30,000 books read online by students in K through 5 as of February, with still several months to go. So please take time to read about our accomplishments. I could go on and on, and since there's no school tomorrow, it would be very dangerous for me to just go on and on and continue this meeting with bragging about the schools. Back when I presented the budget in January, I was asking the Board of Education to consider a 3.75% increase. And I'll go through in just a minute how we got there. Obviously, in early February, a little wrench was thrown into all that when the governor presented his budget proposals, which, unfortunately for a community like East Hampton, hits us very hard. You've heard Mike talk about that. And so when you look at a history of our budget increases by percentage, 2013 it was a 3% increase, and over the last several years it's dropped about a percentage increase. Last year was an increase of 0.90, and unfortunately, due to a number of things, we're expecting that to be a little bit higher this year. One of the drivers, and you heard Mike explain this briefly, one of the drivers for us is health insurance increase. And if you look at the number, we're trending very high. Mike used a figure of around 28%. We have actually budgeted 20% at this point. We've been enjoying 7%, 5% increases, 5% increase. Just to give you a sense, a 5% increase insurance is about a $200,000 increase. So another 15% on top of that is about an additional $600,000. So if I just... bear with me while I go back to this slide. That $1 million increase, about $600,000 of that can be directly attributed to health insurance increases. And then after that, when we were sitting on top of the 3.75, the governor's proposal has just created moving targets. Every town is just scratching their head on what to do. And we're not getting a lot of help from the state legislature because they're saying, well, you know, don't expect a budget from us until June, July. Some people have said September, which is a pretty scary proposition. But obviously, you heard Mike talk about the education cost share dollars, the change in special ed. I love the way they refer to the teacher's retirement as a local contribution to the retirement, and then continued unfunded mandates, which still are part of the legislation. Just to give you a picture of this year's ECS dollars, 2016-17, last spring, you'll recall, we pushed back the referendum because we knew there were going to be cuts to municipal aid. The school took a hit of $100,000, and then again in December of this year, the governor cut an additional $75,000 in ECS dollars. So if you look at that red line, we ended up this year with ECS dollars of $7.5 million. That's lower than the rates even back 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011. But here's the horrific part. In the governor's proposal, the ECS dollars to East Hampton are cut from, I was complaining about the $7.5 million just a moment ago, they're cut down about $4,200,000. So that's a decrease of roughly $3.2 million, or a 43% reduction in ECS funds. So what the governor has done is completely taken the ECS formula that existed, that wasn't really followed, come up with a new formula, and it hits towns like East Hampton very hard. Another thing, and Mike has explained both of these very quickly, the special ed reimbursement to towns gets it replaced with a grant to towns from the state. Not a lot of details yet on how that works. And then the state's responsibility to fund the teachers' retirement system, which quite frankly, they have not held up their responsibility over the years, but now they're passing that responsibility onto towns. This was my favorite slide from the budget presentation, because we're at the point where we're just drowning in unfunded mandates. And I've underlined the ones that are new, and that does not include legislation that is still pending in Hartford for new unfunded mandates. So it's interesting that, you know, as the governor presented his budget of reduction to us of $3.2 million, he didn't really talk about what mandates we were going to be able to dispense with. So just very briefly, and I know a lot of you are familiar with this slide because I've talked about it in my weekly update. The last year's $7.5 million in ECS is replaced by $4.2 million. The education cost share, this is roughly what we anticipated to get this year. It's a reimbursement of special ed costs. They're proposing replacing that with a grant that's actually higher than our reimbursement, but because of the loss of of ECS, we're still at a 1.6 deficit, and then add to that the $1.5 million contribution to the teachers' retirement system. So in the town's budget, you've seen the shortfall. Mike listed the shortfall of education and teachers, the education cost share grant, and the excess cost at 1.6, and then we still have that 1.5 deficit. Now, it's difficult to say, is this what the legislature is going to approve? And, you know, in going to Hartford and sitting through meetings, people have said, yeah, it's not going to be this, but there are going to be cuts. That doesn't help us. What we need for them to do is get on the wagon, break down, solve the budget. Put a budget together. I every day I read how they're talking about legalizing marijuana. I want to hear how they're solving, for towns, the problem of putting a budget together. So let me explain this slide carefully, because after March 1st, superintendent of schools nor the Board of Education can add any money into their budget. So our budget was due to the town on March 1. Not knowing where the state is going or how they're going to resolve the governor's proposals, I pushed forward to the board to consider a 3.75% increase, and in addition to that, a $1.6 million line item that we've just called contingency. So that 1.6, I haven't targeted that for money for new teachers or computers or anything like that. We've just left it as a separate and distinct line item called contingency. Once again, because after March 1, I can't go to the Board of Finance or the Town Council and say, oh my goodness, you know, I thought it wasn't going to happen, but it did. I need 1.6, or I need 1.2, or I need 500,000, based on what the state legislature has done. So we've put $1.6 million in as a line item, just as a contingency. It kind of gave us time during the month of April and May to find out what's going on at the state. that may not even be enough time. But I don't want people to be confused with that 3.75, which we can identify line item by line item with an additional 1.6 million. We're not using that 1.6 to buy anything new or add anything to the school. It's just to cover us in case the state legislature does pass on some of the governor's proposals to us. What the Board of Finance decides to do that with that and the town council, I know will be the discussion of many of our meetings coming forward. So let me just start quickly with, and I won't take too long here, why the 3.75? I gave it my best effort to follow the town council's budget philosophy this year, where they said minimize new personnel. And this year we did not add any personnel. Last year we cut 3 personnel. This year the only personnel that's added is actually a reinstated position based on known retirements. And then they also asked us to limit increases to contractual obligations. This budget is well below the contractual obligations. I would be asking for another 1.5% on top of that, or 1.75% on top of that, to just cover the contractual obligations. So to get to that 3.75, we've made several cuts in other line items so that we're at 3.75 and not higher. Just to get to that 3.75, we've reassigned a teaching position for Memorial and Cedric schools. We're cutting back on a certified math intervention teacher. We're reducing one of our administrative positions, 12-month assistant principal. We're dropping down to 10 months. We're reducing other non-certified staff positions. And there's cuts to supplies, equipment, textbooks. Karen's done a great job. You can go and you can see how much every line item was last year and how much every line item is this year. You'll see for a lot of the line items and supplies and equipment and textbooks and things like that, if they're not zero, they are less than they were last year. So why the 1.6 million contingency on top of that? I think it would be absolutely irresponsible of me to hand in a budget to the town that didn't at least acknowledge that there's something going on in Hartford that could damage the schools to a tremendous amount. To be left without 1.6 million or 3.2 million just completely damages the schools. And I just did not feel I could just put 3.75 forward, stick our heads in the sand, and just hope that everything's going to be okay. I gotta buy a new battery for this as well.
Tomorrow you won't.
Yeah. Wednesday or Thursday. But, you know, even with that news from the state, we are still moving forward, and I'll tell you how we're going to do it. Every item I'm about to tell you is a new item in the budget, but we've offset it with known retirements. So we didn't do anything that we didn't know we could cover with known teacher retirements. The high school is going through its 10-year accreditation. This is not a new luxury item, but it costs about $35,000 by the time you pay for the expenses of the 16 people who will spend 4 days in East Hampton, by the time you pay NEASC, your accreditation fee, the editing of the report fee, et cetera. That's about $35,000. We have to do it once every 10 years. Your next superintendent 10 years from now will tell you that, you know, remember back in 2018 when you did the accreditation, 2028, I could still be here if I did. And one of the other things we're going to do is we are going to reinstate one of the center school teachers. And we're actually doing this not by really adding a teacher, but by moving things around. And once again, this is being paid for by known retirements. Without doing that, our class sizes next year would be in the 26, 27, 28 range like they are with fifth grade. Any fifth grade parent who wants to speak tonight and tell what it's like to have 28 kids in the class, please feel free to speak at one of the upcoming meetings. With that teacher reinstated, we keep class sizes anywhere from the 20s to 23 in grade 5. One of the other things we're doing is we lost 3 teachers at the middle school last year. We're only looking to return 0.4 of a science teacher. As you can see in red, our largest class sizes now are going into the middle school. So where we had classes of 132 in grade 6 and 138 in grade 8, over the next couple of years, those move out, and we replace them with 160, 164, 153. And what this does is, just even out all of the sections in the middle school. This year we have several sections that are 29 and 30 in some of the classes. And then this was a request of several board members and several parents to add some JV teams, JV volleyball and JV cheerleading, two of our most popular programs that unfortunately we have to cut students from, and a 0.2 addition to a part-time music teacher. We're adding a position to help with technology at the high school, but we're not adding any people. This is a $0 cost. It is something new. We're just relocating staff, reassigning staff. And then I list this here as well. We're going with option 3, which is $0. This has the potential to save the district up to $300,000 to $500,000 a year. Rather than do costly outplacements, if we can create a program within our own schools that supports those students in an appropriate way, and we're calling it the STARS program, we're hoping to avoid outplacements or bring students back. By the time we pay tuition and transportation costs for certain students, that student can cost us $150,000, $175,000. So we're looking to make sure that we have appropriate programming in our schools. The reason I mention these is everything I've just described would offset against known retirements. So we're able to do these things with what we know as teacher retirements, obviously when someone retires and you can bring somebody in at a lower cost, there's savings to be had. If you look through this packet, and I urge you to, you'll see everything we called the yellow tier and the red tier. The green lights that I used is the green tier. Those things are in the budget. There's about a page and a half of yellow items that people ask that we really considered putting in the budget. We were looking to work with the town to add a school resource officer. The town would pay 30%, the school would pay 70%. That officer would be available to both the school and the town. There are several other positions that we considered. I won't take up time talking about them. You're welcome to read about them online. And then the red tier, which unfortunately were mentioned but really didn't make part of the discussion. There's about 3 pages in this book of red tier items that people wanted us to consider. Moving on, I just wanted to share, this is a quick enrollment picture, and there's some detail in online and in the budget book. From 2012-13, 4 years, to 2015-16, all of these schools that are listed here, and I apologize for the small writing, all of these schools are similar to us in that they have their own high school. We don't send, these towns don't send students anywhere but to their own high school or magnet schools. They're not K-8 districts, they're all K-12 districts. Some are close to us, some a little further away. All have had declining enrollments over the last 4 years. Our enrollment has actually gone up about 0.7%, or in other words, it stayed pretty still. But the change in per pupil expenditure in these same towns, you can see have gone up, and ours has remained in the last 4 years about the same. These are now schools that are in our district reference group. A 2-year difference between per pupil expenditure. In the state average was about a 4% increase, that red line right in the middle. And you can see East Hampton is here with roughly a 0% increase. It's statistically not zero, it's a little higher than zero. But the per pupil expenditure in our district reference group, state average is 4. We're certainly on the low end of that. And then if you just take local towns, because I know some people don't like to compare to the district reference group, here's local towns. And I apologize again for the small reading. Online, you can see them. These are all local groups. Once again, change in per pupil expenditure, 14-15 to 15-16, state average 4%, we're at zero, and you can see everybody else is going up. So, you know, when I talk about those accolades, the town is getting a pretty nice bargain on its schools. As we wrap up, just some of the things that I'd ask you to consider. This is not what classrooms look like anymore. And a lot of people, you know, I come to these meetings and people say, well, you know, I didn't have a computer when I went to school. Our classrooms don't look like this anymore, except at the center school and some of the middle school classes where they have this many students in them. These are our students. Literally, these are middle school students from East Hampton with their Chromebooks. Showing you what they can do. Every student has a Chromebook assigned to them in the middle school. We hand them out at the beginning of the day. They check them out of their homeroom and check them back in at the end of the day. Our hope is to do that at the high school next year. That was one of the things that you saw, one of those capital expenditures. This is a group of students who are ready for the challenges when they get to high school and to college. I love the smiles and the confidence. When we're looking for what is essential for students in the future, these students are getting it from your schools right now. I have not been quiet on Facebook or to anyone that will listen to me about the governor's proposals. Should some of his proposals go through, it could mean anywhere from 15 to 20 to 25 certified staff members. A loss of $1.6 million focused right on the schools would result in 20 teachers. And I, you know, it's things besides teachers. It's a custodian or two, but, you know, our schools are not overflowing with custodians. And I don't want to make it sound like our schools are overflowing with teachers. But to find 20 teachers right now, it drastically changes the East Hampton Public Schools. So I am urging you to ask our governor to find another solution. And I compliment many of the people here. One of the Friday mornings in February, during my coffee with the superintendent, we invited Melissa Gebron. She was willing to come in from 7 to 8, and there were 100 parents there to greet her on 94 Main Street and beg her, as she sits on the Appropriations Committee, to find other solutions besides solving the state's budget woes on the back of East Hampton children. That's all, thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Mike. Appreciate it. So the next item is the budget discussion. I don't know if any of you have questions for Mike or Paul on some of the material that they covered.
I did have one question. Okay. The drastic cost in healthcare premiums. On the town side, they're bidding it out. Or they bid it out.
We do it together. So the board of ed and the town work together.
Oh, okay. So that's a possibility of reducing that 20% that's in the works.
Well, it's experience related, so it's based on the experience of the town, based on the experience of the board of ed. So I know for the town, ours, we can reduce. I don't know if we can reduce as much as the board of ed.
Steve, similar to Mike, we'll go into negotiation with our unions and discuss other possibilities.
Okay. Thanks.
Anyone else? Because I do have one question. Relative to the pension obligation that the government proposal is pushing towards us, I'm curious as to the level of detail that they provided, because I think we've all heard that pension liabilities have been significantly underfunded for quite a long time in Connecticut. So I was just wondering if they've given us detail to determine whether the 1.6 that they're allocating to us is a current year, what it would be a normal current year allocation, or is it catching up some of the underfunding that the state has historically been dealt with?
Part of my understanding of
this push, the transfer was processed due to investment rate assumption.
Right.
They went from 8.5% right now to 8%. But keep in perspective, they're $13 billion underfunded. The state's teachers pension plan, $13 billion underfunded right now. They're only funded, they're funded less than 60%. They're between 52 and 56% funded. So that's all I have right now. The actuarial valuation's on the website. Look at it.
Mark, if I may, we were given a figure of roughly 1.5 something, and it measured it out, so next year would be like 1.7 something. So, you know, and if I can get back on the soapbox for a minute, here was the governor who said, we've got to be fair to towns that are underfunded, so let's completely redo the education cost share grant. Taking money from towns like East Hampton and putting it elsewhere, which is a noble cause. But then the teacher retirement, it was 30% flat to every town, regardless of their ability to pay. So, you know, there's just two different, in one proposal, just two different philosophies. And at the same time, you know, the impact, there's no indication of how it affects MBR. There's legislation to either remove MBR or reconsider the MBR, the minimum budget requirement. So there's so much up in the air right now that we've all got our work cut out for us, and nobody's giving us the directions.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I know that some towns find savings in cooperating and purchasing supplies between the town and the Board of Ed. Do we do any of that here in East Hampton, and is it a possibility to save some money there?
Sharing supplies? Or?
Purchasing, the combining and purchasing.
Either
I know Bristol does
not,
it. And,
yeah.
I'm sorry?
Well, I'm trying to figure out what supplies are you talking about?
Not athletic socks, obviously.
Yeah.
But, you know, paper,
most
whatever,
of,
I don't know.
Candidly, most of what we get is on the state bid list, and I think we're both ordering from that state bid list. But, you know, I'll be honest, I did an exercise with a group of parents that came to sit with me, and we went through and we looked at the supplies that each department have and each building have, and I don't think we hit $120,000 total throughout our four buildings. So, you know, the amount of money that supplies constitute in this budget is just such a small amount. But I think everything we do is, you know, by the state bid price or anything that we can get. And I mean, the state bid price is pretty much the lowest price for everything out there right now.
Any other comments?
Just a general comment. We're going to be faced, obviously, with a huge problem, lack of better words. The Legislative Appropriations Committee doesn't even reach their reporting date until April 28th. We're probably not going to know at that date what the impact on our budget is. So we're going to have some things to do, and probably need to be discussing with the town manager and the town council about when we actually report a budget. My gut is that things not going to have a budget at a minimum until June. They'll probably be a special session, very likely right into the summer. And we, for our taxpayers, need to come up with something. So it's going to be imperative on us to track a course, whether we do a budget and plan on coming back for a new budget session after the state finishes, or whether we anticipate something up front. But in one case, we could be possibly seriously overtaxing citizens if the state changes its direction after we have a budget. Not to think about.
I agree with that. I think it's fair to say that we have a challenge.
Excuse me? I don't mean to interrupt, but could the board please speak up? The whole back section can't hear anything.
I'll try to be loud.
Thank you, appreciate it.
Dee and I agree with you. I believe we're going to have a challenging timeframe, whether it's the next few weeks or the next few months. It's certainly going to be a challenge. There's a great deal of uncertainty that both Mike and Paul pointed out. Any other comments? Based on the fact that there are so many people here, and I know some people walked in and risking the abuse of my fellow board members, I would like to open up another session of public comments. So if you'd like to say something, to reiterate what I said before, name, address, and if you could keep your comments relatively brief, it would be greatly appreciated. So with that, is there anybody interested in making some remarks? All right, thank you. Terrific. Saved me from abuse of my conversation. with that,
One quick question for Jeff. How are you going to let us know by email what our schedule is not going to be for the week? Because obviously we're not going to meet tomorrow, and that may change the week to Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Right, so the meeting tomorrow is going to be canceled. The departments that we're going to present tomorrow, we're going to try to wrap into Wednesday, Thursday, and Saturday. I'll touch base with them and find out what their availability is over those 3 days and just add them to the agenda.
Can you wrap anybody into Wednesday? Because don't you have to have public notice 24 hours in advance and the town hall closed and won't be able to do it?
It's basically just a workshop, so
okay.
I might not do that just in the event that someone did specifically come out to see someone on Tuesday and not be able to see them. So I'll probably see if I can wrap them on Thursday or Saturday. Nothing on Friday right now. We're scheduled for 6 on Friday for the quarterback.
All right. Without, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Are you opposed?